Well, folks, it's finally that time. Yes, my little series has been online and semi-operational for a year today, and what better way to celebrate it than with another list that proves what a complete dork I am. The Anita Blake series started off with a very interesting novel called Guilty Pleasures. I've decided to give you a taste of that. I'm going to list my top 30 guiltiest pleasures. Now, when I say guilty pleasures, I mean anything that I enjoy that isn't strictly well-made by the most basic standard. These are TV shows and movies that I would not argue are good, just entertaining. And believe me when I say there's a difference. They are in the order of just how guilty I feel about enjoying them. Let's dive right in and see how quickly your respect for me dwindles with every number. I cheated myself. Number 30, Desperado. There is no other way to start off a list of guilty pleasures than a Robert Rodriguez movie. Desperado is a spiritual sequel to El Mariachi, which I admit I haven't seen, but you don't really need to in order to understand the movie. The plot is simple. There is a man they call El Mariachi, played by the absolutely delicious Antonio Banderas, who is looking for a man called Bucha, who killed his girlfriend and disfigured one of his hands. The best thing about this movie is that it is a collaboration of Rodriguez and Quentin Tarantino, meaning that the dialogue is hilarious, the action sequences are all completely over the top, and the level of irreverence is at its highest setting. Banderas is, of course, the main appeal because he nails every single line with the utmost ham possible. He manages to be intimidating yet charming and never misses a chance to be awesome, whether he's shooting 40 bad guys with one magazine in his gun or making up with Salma Hayek. Besides the Zorro films, this is the movie I consider to be the best of Banderas. It's like a chocolate-covered marshmallow. You don't need it in your diet, but you don't mind popping it in every once in a blue moon. Number 29, Lake Placid. While we're talking about movies that don't take themselves seriously, let's talk about Lake Placid. I watch this movie every single time it comes on. Why? Because it's hilarious and damn near a parody of horror films. If someone had taken this concept seriously, it would probably have turned out to be an awful scary movie. But since they treat the film more like an action comedy, Lake Placid came out on top. There's excellent chemistry between Brendan Gleeson and Oliver Platt that just has to be seen to be believed, and even a solid performance from the sadly forgotten Bill Pullman. Granted, Bridget Fonda's incredibly bitchy character lowers the enjoyment of the film by several pegs, but it's still a very fun movie with some truly original moments. I don't think I've ever seen a bear get owned by a crocodile in any other film, and that is something no one can ever take away from Lake Placid. Also, Betty White, do you need any other reasons why it's awesome? Number 28, Entrapment. This is a stranger pick for me since the other two films before this one are action comedies that don't take themselves seriously. Entrapment is a caper movie about an insurance agent and amateur thief played by the luscious Catherine Zeta-Jones, going undercover to track down the mysterious Raoul McDougal, a seasoned and legendary art thief. It's hard to explain why I like this movie other than my slight lesbian crush on Catherine Zeta-Jones, but I would have to say it's because there are some genuine tense moments of suspense during their caper, and some very good performances from our two main characters. Was I grossed out by the romantic implications between Connery and Jones?
Of course!
Who wasn't? But at the same time, they work very well together, and while the movie was mediocre at best, it still warrants a watch from me on rare occasions it's on cable. Number 27, Dirty Dancing. If you ask me right now why Dirty Dancing is such an American classic, I probably couldn't come up with a reason other than it's just so 80s. 80s hair, 80s music, 80s dialogue, everything from the decade that you can think of is in this movie for the most part. Truth be told, I don't even like it that much, but I still turn it on, and I'm not entirely sure why. It certainly doesn't hold up well through the years because the dialogue is clumsy, the premise is mildly creepy, and everything else is covered in enough cheese to suffocate a mouse.
Cheddar! Ah! Cheddar, where's it?
Having said that, I have to admit that Dirty Dancing has a bit of nostalgic charm to it. The only scene I will ever like is the training montage of Baby learning how to dance because it's very cute and there's plenty of enjoyable bickering between the two lovebirds. The dancing in the film itself is pretty good. Nothing too impressive, but it's certainly not bad. There are worse romance films out there, so it doesn't hurt to get a little dirtier once in a while. Number 26, A Walk in the Clouds. Speaking of romances, this next one is one of the very few true romance films that I admit I like. A Walk in the Clouds is a largely obscure little movie that hit before Keanu got his big break in The Matrix in 1999, and I have to say, out of all of the movies on my list, this is probably the most harmless. The The story is about a soldier, played by Keanu Reeves, returning home from the war who tries to get his life back on track by selling chocolate door-to-door. While he's traveling, he happens to bump into a college student, played by Aitana Sanchez-Gijon, who got knocked up by one of her professors and is returning home to her family's vineyard to tell them. Being a sweet guy, he agrees to pretend to be her husband so her father won't disown her, and gets caught up in the romance and the beauty of the vineyard as he spends time with her family. Yes, it's very cheesy and predictable, but honestly, this movie is so sincere that I can't help but love it. The cultural aspects of the film are its selling point. The family issues, the racial issues, and the drama all come together really well. It's damn near saccharine, but it's the kind of treat you enjoy late at night, curled up with a Dove bar after a long day. Number 25. We're Back, A Dinosaur Story. Alright, I'm just gonna say it. Nostalgia critic be damned, I love this movie. Look, I'm not stupid. I understand that this film is silly in every meaning of the word, but I still love it to death. This is one of my favorite movies growing up because while it had a pretty predictable premise, it was just so much fun to watch and daydream about. The animation is pretty good, the voice acting is lively, and the characters are memorable. More than that, though, it was just a cool movie to act out as a little kid, pretending you have your own pet dinosaur and imagining the adventures you went on. I think that's what drew me to this film in general. It voiced a very common wish of a child. For dinosaurs to be alive and breathing and completely awesome. When you're an adult, sure, this movie loses a lot of its magic, but it's great for children. Besides, it has a very sinister villain and one of my favorite kids' movie songs, Roll Back the Rock. I still remember the words to this day, and I don't care if it makes me a nerd. I'll just take that hit.
Roll back the rock.
Roll back the rock.
Turn back the clock.
Turn back the clock.
Roll back the rock to the dawn of time and sing this song with me.
Number 24, Swordfish. I think I may be the only person on the planet who likes this movie. Honestly, I can't really understand why people hated it. It had a relatively solid plot up until the third act, some pretty good acting, and interesting cinematography. While I admit that the last half hour of the film really takes away from the rest of it, I've always felt it's a good background movie, the kind you have on the TV while you're doing your homework. Every once in a while you look up and there's a cool scene, such as Hugh Jackman wearing nothing but a towel, or Halle Berry topless, your mileage may vary, and then get back to work. There's plenty of performances to enjoy, particularly Travolta, Jackman, and Cheadle. It's got a high-energy feel to the action scenes, and it manages to pull off some very tense confrontations throughout the movie. If you can ignore the poor attempts at political satire, it's worth a shot, in my humble opinion. Number 23, Look Who's Talking. Do I really need to explain this one? You can lie to yourself if you want, but you have to admit that this movie is intensely cute. Could you do something like this in modern times? Hell no. This is the perfect kind of late 80s romantic comedy. Bruce Willis plays a charming, precocious little baby, Kirstie Alley is at her hottest, snarkiest point in her career, and John Travolta is still funny rather than disturbed and creepy. While this movie is certainly adorable, it's also surprisingly genuine. There are several well-acted emotional scenes, such as the ending scene when they race to find Mikey after he's gotten lost in the city. Besides, anything with Abe Vigoda in it has my vote. Well, almost anything. Number 22, Armageddon. Time for more of my notorious unpopular opinion. I am not a fan of Michael Bay, but I will admit that I defend some of his films every once in a while. One of the movies I will always defend is Armageddon, mostly because it accomplishes more than it messes up in my eyes. Is the plot impossible and contrived? Sure. But at the same time, it's a perfect action movie because it's a simple premise that doesn't take forever to explain. The Earth is going to get blown up by a meteor. Get Bruce Willis and a team of drillers to drop a nuke and blow it the hell up. And bam, said the lady, you've got one of the biggest blockbusters of the late 90s. More than that, though, the movie has an all-star cast who really made the trip worthwhile, and that's what really bugs me about people who constantly bitch about the movie. We should at least thank the casting director for uniting so many entertaining actors in one place and actually writing them well. Aside from the Die Hard franchise and The Fifth Element, this is still one of my favorite Bruce Willis performances because he really commits to the part. All of the other actors seem to feed off of him and gave really great reads, even Ben Affleck. Every time this movie comes on, I have to sit down for the same three scenes. Beginning where Harry chases AJ with a shotgun, the scene where they get the team to NASA and train them, and the ending. Say what you want about the film, but Harry's goodbye to AJ is still one of the best emotional scenes I've seen in a movie, and certainly the most heartfelt scene in any Michael Bay movie. I say all that to say this, Michael Bay ain't perfect and never will be, but give credit where credit is due. Number 21, Australia. As I mentioned before, there are very, very few true romance films that I like, but I have to admit that for all its faults, I do like Australia. Once again, I know this is a pretty unpopular opinion. It's long, it's pretty slow, and it isn't sure what kind of movie it wants to be. But the first hour or so, it's an adventure film of the get from point A to point B and don't let the bad guys stop us along the way proportions. However, when you plunge into the second hour and a half, it's full of war stories and racial hatred. It doesn't really blend the two well, but at the same time, the reason I like the movie isn't because of those factors. Hugh Jackman and Nicole Kidman work well together and gave solid performances, the scenery is gorgeous, and the little boy, played by Brandon Walters, was fascinating to watch. It should be noted that this is now Hugh Jackman's second appearance on my list, and that it isn't his last. He seems to have this weird habit of appearing in films that would be otherwise awful without his presence, but since he's there, he boosts them up to watchable. He's like Christopher Walken. Yeah, I went there.
Guess what? I got a fever! And the only prescription is more cowbell!
Number 20, Surf Ninjas. Even I can admit that I don't have an excuse for this one. Surf Ninjas is a goofy, damn near incomprehensible kids film about, well, the title. They are surfing ninjas. But for its many, many faults, it's got a kind of kids movie camp that works for me. I grew up with this movie, and despite the fact that it's pretty stupid, it's also sort of cute. The main character isn't all that smart, but he is kind of charming in his own way. There are a few genuinely funny moments, particularly the end cover of Barbaran, and even a couple of one-liners for Rob Schneider. I wouldn't recommend this movie to anyone, but I certainly don't mind turning it on for a few scenes.
1, 2, dudes!
Number 19, Kate and Leopold. What did I tell you? That's Hugh Jackman's third entry on my list. Notwithstanding, the reason this romantic comedy isn't a quote-unquote good movie is because the plot is utterly confusing and nonsensical. Also, Meg Ryan's character is kind of hard to like because she's a neurotic bitch for a large part of the movie. But like Swordfish in Australia, Hugh Jackman saves the film. Every single second he's on the screen is heavenly. The British accent, the smile, and the charm all make up for the other shortcomings. It makes you feel invested in the love story, and even if his love interest isn't cosmically likable, you still want them to be together by the end of the movie, just so he'll be happy. Number 18, Reign of Fire. Everyone has a handful of dumb action movies that they like, and this is one of mine. Truthfully, this movie has a similar problem to Transformers 2. We came for dragons and we got an hour and a half of humans running around bickering with each other and maybe 10 solid minutes of dragons. I know that you need to establish your cast so that we actually care about them making it through to the end of the movie, but they went overboard and barely showed a dragon until the final act. However, when we did get to see the dragons, they were amazing and actually pretty realistic, with the liquid chemicals being the cause of their fire breathing. Also, there's the incredible performance of Matthew Ladies Man McConaughey, who handed up every single line he was in to become the manliest dragon slayer since Bowen. You just can't bring yourself to hate him in this film because he overacts every line they give him, and it's delicious. Look at him! He thinks he's people! Number 17, Chronicles of Riddick. Speaking of terrible action films, The Chronicles of Riddick is baffling. Take a relatively creative and interesting horror film called Pitch Black, put the most badass character into his own story, and make it cool. That doesn't sound too hard, right? But somehow Chronicles managed to muck that up with adding too many characters, too many cheesy actors, and removing the horror element of the film. While the addition of Kira, played by Alexa Davalos, was a welcome twist, it still couldn't find its way back to being as cool as its potential. The main problem is that it never really established what the relationship is between Kira and Riddick. Throughout the whole movie, Riddick treads the line between being her guardian and being her potential love interest. Depending on your point of view, the love interest thing can come across as creepy when you think about the fact that she was a child in the movie before this one, even though it's been clearly close to a decade. Having said that, there's just something about this movie that drags me in every time. I love that Vin Diesel is so engrossed in his role as Riddick, who is the quintessential criminal with hidden depths. While that's nothing new, it's Diesel's utter commitment to the character that makes me enjoy the film, not to mention a handful of truly cool action sequences. It doesn't help that G4 TV plays it every other weekend, but then again, it's not like that channel has anything better to do. Number 16, Vampire Night. Like many girls, I am vulnerable to liking incredibly stupid and girly things, and one of said stupid and girly things is Vampire Night. I was introduced to the anime through a club at my university, and became hooked on it mainly on the fact that Zero, one of the main protagonists, was an incredibly hot and brooding and emotionally damaged vampire who hated his own kind and wanted nothing more than to eradicate them. Despite the fact that he's a massive emo kid, I found myself deeply in love with him for several months. And then I outgrew the series because aside from the super hot Zero and Akatsuki Kane, there's nothing good about the series. The anime is mediocre at best and horribly melodramatic, and the manga is slower than a glacier climbing uphill. Nothing ever happens. Ever. This entry would be higher up if I still liked it, but I don't, so it's more like a shameful one-night stand than a true guilty pleasure.